to destruction, it has been published fairly well, I think, in U.S. press. So, but really, this has been the most devastating natural disaster in Puerto Rico in history. And the country is devastated at all levels, including the shore has been deep erosion, entire communities washed out, buildings, thousands of people have lost everything, and it's just a monumental catastrophe. It is a humanitarian crisis, including with refugees inside of Puerto Rico. And this, and when I say Puerto Rico, I'm saying, you know, the big island. There are two smaller islands, Vieques, which was the one that was used by the Navy for military practice, and Culebra, who were hit before by Irma. You know, on top of that destruction, I just received some email, and I haven't been able to open it, from an aerial view of Vieques saying that it is completely destroyed. It's unimaginable. The destruction. Deaths are not really being reported. The government is saying that there were 16 deaths, but by other accounts, they are saying that there are dozens of deaths that have not been reported because there are places for compensate that there has been no communication. In fact, there is no communication almost at all in the island by cell phone. Only a few spots there are some signals, and whoever is lucky to get to those places can get, like, you know, maybe 1 hour, not to rush that. But no communication. So the government is relying on satellite phones. But this morning, the report that the satellites that they were that supposedly the government gave to every mayor, and there are 78 municipalities, so that means 78 mayors in the island, in Puerto Rico, not all these phones were working. So it's completely a chaos. This is on top of the, and I'm going to give just a brief before Irma and Maria. There was already chaos by the Promesa law, which was Puerto Rico owes supposedly owes $74 billion to really vulture funds in Wall Street, and the Congress imposed this Promesa law, which imposed a fiscal control board that is really an ATM to pay the $74 billion in what is really an illegitimate, and the international law is called an odious, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it well, odious debt, which is illegitimate. Because it's legally, it says that a national debt that was incurred by a government, by a regime, for purposes that do not serve the best interest of the nation, and they should not be enforceable. And that is the case, because these debts were not for infrastructure, were not, you know, for the benefit of the people. Were, in fact, to pay service of debt on top of debt. So anyway, all these debts have prevented the government also from borrowing at favorable interest rates. So every loan, and these were, you know, municipal bonds. So any kind of loan that the government made after being you know, on the like the Moody's and I cannot think of the name, the agencies that that regulate, not to regulate, that qualify the worse the bonds, the higher the interest. So all this prevented from the government to borrow at favorable interest. So it was like a whirlwind of increased debt up to $74 billion. That's why the U.S. Congress imposed this fiscal control board. Now, this fiscal control board, of course, not elected. It was named by Congress with Obama nominating one or two members and the governor fiscal nominating one. But this is a really... members who are not, they are including two members that were directly involved in setting up the crisis by the creation of bonds created by Banco de Santander. These two members were not only executives in Banco de Santander at one point when they did that, but they were also from the Development Bank of Puerto Rico, which was the agency, more like the fiscal sponsor and the fiscal, like the treasurer of Puerto Rico. That's where, you know, all the government money went through. So they had really a conflict of interest, and yet they are part of the fiscal control board. And that's one of the one of the reasons why the fiscal control board demands is to get it out and, you know, completely overturn it. So the another thing about this fiscal control board is that they nominated and now as the executive director. A woman, a U.S. woman with you know, Ukrainian, U.S. Ukrainian woman called Natalie Jaresko. And interestingly, this Natalie Jaresko was working with the U.S. State Department in Ukraine and was the Minister of Finances from 2014 to 2016, and she had initiated, she founded this firm, an investment firm called Horizon Capital, and that Horizon Capital includes the recent acquirement, acquisition, I don't know if that word is, or buying, the first the national telecommunication agency in Ukraine. So you can see what this fiscal control board director is, why was she set up in Puerto Rico, and with a country that owes supposedly so much and where poverty is increasing, that she gets paid more than $500,000 a year. It's just outrageous. So in this background, this Joaquina and Maria, there was also the imposition of a fiscal plan between the government, and that was approved by the Fiscal Control Board, that will reduce the workday like 2 days from the month, and of course this is not a progressive thing. It's not that, you know, you don't work 2 days a month and you get paid. Not on you don't get paid, and pension reduction, layoff, all sorts of austerity plan. This is really a acute austerity plan. Which is, you know, the result. And this was starting actually in the beginning, you know, of this month. So all this is where, you know, Maria came in, and one of the key aims of this plan is to privatize state enterprises, particularly the energy sector. That's really where they have set their eyes, and this is not new. This has been from different government administrations an attempt to privatize the energy sector, and particularly privatize the generation of electricity, not the distribution, because they say, you know, the distribution is very labor intensive. That will be paid by Puerto Rico, which is the most difficult and less profitable. What they want to privatize is the generation, which is very profitable. And actually, there are two plants like already privatized. Two of the, you know, the whole energy has not been privatized. So there are two private plants that are operating, and it really has been before the hurricanes were the center of an intense struggle, because they use coal from Colombia, and it's very toxic. So they accumulate these toxic ashes that are then transported in trucks without any cover, you know, on top. So they are blowing the wind. They are really contaminating the whole distance of town, the whole area. So there is a struggle, you know, it's called, you know, the town where they have been in Peñuela, in mountains and mountains of toxic ashes, and this is the private. So that's, and one of the postulates of the Promesa is that the privatization of the energy sector, so that this is clear that they want that. And along privatization, they also want, of course, join the union, which is the most militant union of the country that is not associated with the AFL-CIO. So this is a little bit of the background. And of course, you know, schools, politicians, and all that have been part of the fiscal plan. So here comes Hurricane Maria, and there is this whole destruction of electricity. There is, to this point, to this day, of electricity, the only electricity is by generators, which need diesel. And diesel is like now the most sought out commodity. And there is, you know, Puerto Rico is an island, so everything depends on shipping. And there hasn't been distribution of diesel. And this has really, this is the main thing that has made this situation critical, because not having electricity, both by electricity or by generators with diesel, there have been deaths, because many hospitals had to close. The machinery didn't work. People who have, you know, the dialysis, that need oxygen, that need electricity for any kind of life-saving machine, it doesn't work. It's not. And many people who are sick have to be transported to the central medical center in San Juan. But then there is the other problem, that there is no gasoline, because it depends on the shipping, and the shipping, even if it's in the port, it cannot be distributed. So this becomes the whole crisis. For example, in the gasoline, you can see there is a curfew, so people are not supposed to be on the street between 7 p.m. to 5 a.m. But people are defying that, because they need, there is no public transportation, so people depend only on cars, on their, you know, private cars, but there is no gasoline, so they have to go to the gas station. And sometimes they stay there for more than one day just to wait for, and approximately half of the gasoline station have been damaged by the storm. So there are towns that simply don't have one working gas station. So it's a completely crisis, and there have been deaths. There have been many deaths. In terms of deaths, for example, the funeral homes cannot have preservation because there is no electricity. You know, they depend on the refrigeration of the bodies of the cadavers. There has been in Lares, for example, it's a small town in the west. It has one cemetery, and the whole cemetery, you know, there were hundreds of bodies unearthed by the pressure of the water. People are even burying their dead at home, which is bringing also another problem because there is no license, they need a certification, but there are places, for example, in the mountains, like way that they can go out because the roads and the bridges have been broken, and there is no way to get out. At this time, also, people who want to leave the island cannot go. The airlines wanted to benefit that, and they jacked up the prices. Usually the round trip to Puerto Rico, U.S., from the U.S. to Puerto Rico is like 300 and so. That's huge. They rack it up to 1,000 and one way, and sometimes even $3,000 for a round of trip. Now that has been, you know, they had to lower that, but it shows how all these vultures just want to benefit from this horrendous crisis. So in this aftermath, both the government of Puerto Rico, which is completely subservient to the United States and is a pro-statehood, it has been completely dissolved, give misinformation to the people, saying, well, we have a lot of visa, we have a lot of food, but people go to the supermarkets and the shelves are empty. They go to the gas station and there is no gas. They don't have water. So all this misinformation is making people really desperate. And then the government only looks to the United States for solutions, even though there have been, there are many experts, there is a lot of experience and expertise in, professionals and even people who have been governors before that have been more experienced and that have been, have more common sense, and they have offered solutions. Yet this new government, it doesn't pay any attention. The unions have given great information and proposals, and then from the UPN, retired workers say, I'm willing to go back to work just to help. And the government just not. They want to really turn Puerto Rico into a quote state, which cannot, but bringing professionals and workers from the United States and ignoring completely what the Puerto Rican availability and advice that they're giving. And the worst thing is also the calling for militarization, which is, it has been imposed from the United States, but of course, it's presented as, we're asking for militarization, we're asking for you know, a center command of the Pentagon here to direct the relief operation, because we are so small, we don't have the capability of doing this. So this is very dangerous. This morning there was a press conference with all these FEMA and Navy and Marine, all these federal military people with the government, with the governor, saying what they were going to do, and they are going to do distribution, they are going to set up another airfield in Saipan, which is where the Roosevelt Road base that is now closed, that they want to reopen and set up this airfield, supposedly to bring and relieve the international airport, which was damaged. This is very dangerous, because in 1899, 1 year after the U.S. invaded, there was a hurricane called San Ciriaco, and that served to really mold Puerto Rico into what the United States wanted. They changed the peso for the dollar. The peso was the monetary, was the currency in Puerto Rico at that time. They changed the agriculture, you know, with fruits and vegetables and coffee and tobacco, which was exported. They changed it to sugar. So this helped to really set up the kind of colonial structure that the United States wanted and needed at that time. This will do the same thing. I see it like the second phase of colonialism, where they will set up Puerto Rico into what they need. And Albizu Campos, you know, our national hero, said it once. He said, you know, the United States wants the cage, but not the bird. And one of the things that has been happening with the economic crisis and, you know, the whole fiscal plan is that there has been the most massive in the Puerto Rican history of migration to the United States, to the point that they are saying now that by 2020 there will be, you know, a million and half, something like that, Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico, that the rest. At now, it's 3.4 million, and there are more than 5 million in the United States. So it's really also a substitution, because with all the incentives, incentives to the millionaire, not the people, but the billionaires in the United States, to move to Puerto Rico and move it, like, quote unquote, they just have to live in Puerto Rico for 180 days a year and open up a business that will offer two jobs. That's the requirement, and they will have, you know, complete tax track of free on all the gains, capital gains, and I mean it's just incredible. Plus, they are buying the most the best places, the best regions in Puerto Rico, for example, the shores. And the building very luxurious house buildings, which it's not for Puerto Ricans. No Puerto Rican at this point can buy any of this. So that will be the substitution. It's going to be like Hawaii, where there was a substitution, and of course, you know, with the consequence. What else? So the Jones Act, it has been in the news that Trump is going to waive the Jones Act. It's of 1920, it's a law, it's called also the Merchant Marine Law, and really what it means is that any Puerto Rico being an island, get everything by shipping or air, and it has to be shipping and by sea. It has to be only in U.S. vessels made in U.S. with U.S. Personnel. So that means that if we get a card from Japan, they cannot go to Puerto Rico. They have to go to Jacksonville, Florida, which is the port that Puerto Rico with Crawley, and I think there is another company. I don't remember the name now. They have to unload in Jacksonville, change it to a U.S. vessel, and that U.S. vessel with U.S. personnel is the one that goes to Puerto Rico. And of course, this is tremendously expensive. That's why so everything is expensive. And we depend on 85% of what we consume, including foodstuff, in Puerto Rico, because our economy was destroyed and the industries that have been operating since, the agriculture to industry to, manufacturing, software, petrochemical, pharmaceutical, all that, it was for export. It was not for people or what people needed in Puerto Rico. So we have no sovereignty on self-sufficiency on anything, and we cannot get right now. For example, Cuba had offered a hospital, mobile hospital, with 39 personnel between physicians and nurses and all that, and what needed. Venezuela had offered also fuel and things that are needed, and that is pending. Even Panama, and we see, Cuba, Venezuela are, terrorists, deemed terrorists by the U.S. government, but Panama is an ally of the United States. Not even Panama, who was going to send, aid to Puerto Rico, is accepted. Then the other part is, the diaspora in the United States have been just doing an incredible job of getting supplies. Right now, there were 3,000 containers in the ports in Puerto Rico waiting to be distributed. And not only because there was no adequate transportation, and they say there were no drivers and all that, but because of all these bureaucracy that had to go through FEMA, they were even charging the sales value, which was supposed to be waived during this crisis. So there is a lot of bureaucracy. FEMA and the other federal agencies are just stopping any kind of help to Puerto Rico, and what the Puerto Rican people are saying is that first to open the borders and let Cuba, Venezuela, and whoever wants to help get in, repeal the Jones Act right now, an immediate cessation of any payment on the obvious debt, and the cancellation, the total cancellation of the debt, and repeal the and the whole members of the Fiscal Control Board get out of Puerto Rico. And the one thing is reparations now. It's not the thing, it's like we need aid. Of course, people need aid, but people from the government of the United States, what is needed is reparations now for more than 100 years of exploitation. They have to pay for the forced sterilization of women, for the contamination of water, contamination of air, contamination of oil, by the petrochemical, by the coal, by the pharmaceutical plants and the military plants. They have to pay for the destruction of Vieques. They have to pay for the destruction of Culebra, both by the Navy. They have to pay for the death of thousands of young people in the wars that Puerto Rico had nothing to do. And they have to pay for the imposition of the merchant marine that doesn't let us trade with other countries. So those are all some of the crimes that Puerto Rico needs reparations. So when some people say, and some organizations say, we want Puerto Rico, United States to help us and give us this money. Well, this money is the people's, these are reparations. These are things that are owed to Puerto Rico. These are not handouts. This is not charity. So it's, and the other thing is no, the demand is not paying on emergency aid of payments. Supposedly, the Puerto Rico has to pay 25% of what we receive from FEMA, and, you know, it's just criminal. So I guess that, you know, that those are more or less. On the city where you are, for example, the diaspora here, we got like four containers of aid, but there was also a team of nurses and doctors that volunteer. Unfortunately, and that's because of, you know, politicians' corruption and who gets what and who has connection, a team left, but they left the medical team, which is really horrible because they just wanted to accommodate their people. I said, you know, just take pictures, get there, handing out things. So but there is the possibility of having, you know, in different places. I don't know, in New York, because every city will have its own. There are no flights yet that you can. They're beginning now. I think it's like 10 flights back and forth, United States and Puerto Rico, and so it's very, very limited. But I think asking in New York, for example, the organizations that are getting supplies, they do have to get at this point, because there are, you know, not that many flights. It's needed a little pool that can go, you know, can have the waiver of that. It doesn't have to be through FEMA, and actually shouldn't be through FEMA. For example, I'm, for example, I have many relatives who I haven't heard yet, so I cannot do that, but I want to send them like batteries and things like that through mail, but the post office is not, I think it's only one that opened today, and I don't know if it worked. But it's very limited. Of course, FedEx and UPS, none of that is working right now. So there is a limited shipping, not only shipping by sea, but by air. It's really dire. So it's irrespective of FEMA, it's that there are no ways right now. Unless, for example, the Miami, I saw in the news, the Miami mayor took a plane with some supplies for San Juan, for mayor of San Juan, Carmen Yulín, directly, you know, for that. So individuals, if there are organizations that can get some organization that has access to a plane that can, you know, go to Puerto Rico, or one of the airlines when there are more flights to get containers or big boxes of supplies, that will have to happen because it's needed. The needs are dire, the supplies are not enough, so they will have to open more. So it's a matter of, you know, checking. Right now, everything is so uncertain. There is so little information of that. And in Philadelphia, we're waiting to see if we can send a team of health workers and more supplies. I still have, you know, my living room is full of bags of, you know, that neighbors have given me after we sent the four containers. So this is going to be continued. And